Extinction by J.T. Brannan. Read by Jonathan Keeble. Extinction is the rule. Survival is the exception. Carl Sagan. The Varieties of Scientific Experience. A Personal View of the Search for God. Prologue.
Ready?
Clive Burnett asked, excitement written across his weather-beaten features, clear in the intense midday sun of the unforgiving Egyptian desert.
Ready,
Tom Bowers answered, barely suppressing his own excitement. He was the archaeological team's demolitions expert, and he had rigged 40 pounds of plastic explosive to a natural rock formation nestled within the country's fabled Valley of the Kings. Burnett had been a field archaeologist for over 3 decades, and he was convinced this barren desert location was hiding what he had been searching for all these years, the legendary Hall of Records. The hall was one of those common myths of Egyptology that might just be true, a huge repository of ancient texts, including those from the Library of Alexandria, which were thought to have been secreted away in Egypt before that city had been razed to the ground thousands of years before. Years of painstaking, meticulous research had led Burnett to believe that he had at last found the location. The high-altitude X-ray tomography had recently shown a very large structure under these sands. The only trouble was, the 50,000 tons of granite which covered it precluded a dig further into the sand beneath. But Burnett had presented his evidence, and Egypt's Supreme Council of Antiquities had finally relented and authorized the use of explosives to clear the site. As Burnett watched Bowers make his final preparations, he felt a trickle of sweat slide down his face, caused by anticipation, not the fiery heat of the desert sun. Bowers nodded to Burnett as the rest of the team stood watching behind the safety markers. Bowers smiled, one friend to another, and pushed the plunger of the demolitions box. At first, there was nothing. No sound, no explosive concussion, and Burnett feared that the charges had failed to go off. But moments later, he felt the ground shake beneath his feet and grinned as clusters of debris shot high into the pure blue sky above them, shattering the foundations of the rock formation which hid his prize. He could see the rock shivering, resisting the power of the linked explosives, putting up one last fight before it forever relinquished its hold on the sands and shattered. Burnett watched as dust and debris was thrown hundreds of feet into the air, and the solid rock seemed to literally disintegrate before him. He turned to Bowers, 10 feet ahead of him at the limits of the safety zone, and gave him a gleeful thumbs up. But something was wrong. Bowers wasn't smiling. Instead, he seemed alert, confused, scared even. Then he turned fully to Burnett and the rest of the team.
"Get back!"
he yelled at the top of his voice, struggling to be heard over the falling rock.
"It's going down!"
Burnett only had moments to consider what his friend meant. Surely the rock was supposed to be going down, wasn't it? But then he saw what the demolitions expert meant, as the remnants of the vast granite rock slipped beneath the rapidly opening ground, and millions of tons of sand were pulled towards what was now a gigantic sinkhole. Burnett saw Bowers' legs go from under him as he was pulled inexorably towards the ravenous mouth in the middle of the valley. He instinctively made a move forwards to help his friend, but then felt the ground moving once more beneath his feet, rooting him to the spot. His legs seemed useless, turned to stone by the shock of the event, and then arms grabbed him, hauling him further behind the safety lines. His breath ragged, adrenaline coursing through him, he turned and looked one last time at the place where the rock had once stood, and saw his friend's hands disappearing over the edge, pulled deep into the sinkhole in the desert floor. He struggled against the hands of his colleagues, straining to get to his friend, but eventually relaxed, head bowed, resignation taking him. It was too late. Tom Bowers was gone. It was over 12 hours later that the site was deemed secure enough to venture close to it, and the first order Burnett gave was to retrieve the body. He and his team stood at the edge of the sinkhole, which seemed to drop far, far down into the valley floor, straining their eyes to find Tom Bowers. It took several minutes, but the battered form was eventually spotted, half buried in the sand about 30 feet down, one broken arm and two-thirds of his mangled face sticking out grotesquely from the caved-in wall. Burnett was issuing instructions to the retrieval team when he heard a cry from Claire Goodwin, a senior member of the team.
"Get over here!"
There was a beat pause, and then she repeated the call with increased urgency.
"Get over here! Everybody, now!"
Burnett was the first one there. He peered down into the chasm, in the direction Goodwin's finger pointed.
"What?" he asked, irritated by the interruption. "I don't see any..."
Burnett's voice caught in his throat as he saw what Goodwin was pointing at, and it didn't take long for everyone else on the team to spot it too. Metal, glinting dully in the glare of the sun, perhaps 100 feet down. There was no ancient stonework here, only a long curved piece of metal, the outer edge of something far larger still buried. The discovery excited Burnett, but he put aside the archaeological purpose of the mission until the body of Bowers had been retrieved, his family had been, painfully but necessarily, informed, and repatriation arrangements had been made. The funeral was to be held back in the US in 10 days' time, and Burnett decided to postpone his grief and concentrate on the mission at hand, determined that his friend should not have died in vain. Some members of his team suggested the metal structure buried deep beneath the sands might be some sort of war bunker or research facility left over from the Nazis. Hitler was known to have been interested in archaeology, looking for historical evidence in support of his master race theories. He had authorized many digs throughout North Africa and the Middle East, and it was possible that the structure was in some way related to this. But, Burnett argued, how would they have buried it in 100 feet of sand? Over the entire valley, he added, and not just in this one area, and then topped it off with a 50,000-ton geological formation. It was possible that seismic activity might have shifted the sand, but the granite suggested something else. 2 days later, the site had been cleared up, and the walls of the sinkhole shored up and secured, enabling members of the team to descend onto the top of the structure and start clearing away more of the sand and debris.
"What's it made of?" Burnett asked the team's chief metallurgist, John Jackson.
"I'm not exactly sure," Jackson replied. "It seems to be some sort of variant of titanium, but nothing I'm familiar with."
"Can we get through it?"
Jackson thought for a moment, then nodded his head.
"We can, yes. It'll just take some time."
"Get started now, then. We don't know when the locals will turn up, and I want to be inside before they get here."
Jackson announced that he was through more than 6 hours later. Word quickly spread to other parts of the camp, and within minutes all 30 members of the crew were there. The curved metal object was an access hatch, much like a submarine hatch, and was located on what appeared to be the roof of a building still buried underground. The hatch opened to reveal a metallic access tunnel, with a ladder leading down into the dark. Burnett stepped forward and turned on the torch secured to his helmet.
"I'll go first," he announced with authority.
And as he placed his feet on the metal rungs, he only knew one thing. This wasn't the Hall of Records. He hoped that whatever it was would be worth his friend's sacrifice. Claire Goodwin and two other members of the team accompanied Burnett, while the others listened to the radio sets connected to their chief's communication system. There were long pauses as the four archaeologists descended the ladder, Burnett commenting every now and then on the structure of the tunnel and their current depth.
"We're at the bottom," Burnett eventually announced. "We're leaving the access hatch and entering the structure itself."
There was another pause as the team dismounted the ladder, and then everyone still on the surface heard a sharp intake of breath, loud over the radio.
I...
Burnett seemed lost for words. The team members still on the surface heard him breathe deeply several times, trying to collect himself. He continued eventually.
"I don't believe it."
Another pause.
"I've never seen anything like this before in my entire life."
Part 1. Chapter 1. The colossal statue could be seen from miles away by anyone approaching the city on the main freeway that crossed through the rainforest until it broke out onto the coastal plain. The statue loomed over the city from its position, over 2,000 feet high on the mountain, a robed, bearded figure with its arms outstretched towards the ocean beyond. Made out of concrete and soapstone, the 40-meter-high statue had been a symbol of the city for over 90 years, a focal point for the nation's devout religious fervor. Weighing in excess of 700 tons, it was one of the world's largest statues, visited by millions of tourists each year, many of whom made the pilgrimage all the way up to the top of the mountain to stand at the huge pedestal upon which the statue rested. There they stood, craning their necks and looking up in awe at the image of the prophet above them. One such group of pilgrims stood there now, squinting tired eyes into the sun to see their Redeemer in all his glory. And despite the strength of their religion and the passion of their beliefs, nothing in their experience had prepared them for what they saw next. It was early in the morning, a time many people made the pilgrimage to the top of the mountain to watch the sunrise over the horizon. It bathed the statue in an otherworldly glow, making it seem even more impressive, as if the statue and the sun were somehow connected. But this morning was different. As the tourists looked on, believers and non-believers alike, they saw the statue move. The movement of the statue was no mere tilt, as if with the wind, or wobble, as if disturbed at its base. Incredibly, the entire statue leaned backwards and raised its enormous head to look at the rising sun, lifting its gigantic stone arms high above its head. It stopped then, leaning backwards slightly and gazing at the sky between upstretched arms, as if this was how it had stood for almost a century. But the people there knew that this was not the case. They had watched for 2 whole minutes as the statue had moved ever so slowly to reach for the sky, as if asking the heavens themselves for help. But help for what? Soon it wasn't just those who were there who were asking the question. The first footage went out over the social media networks just seconds after it happened. Within 10 minutes, everyone who had filmed it or taken pictures had sent them over the airwaves to family and friends across the globe. And within 30 minutes, the entire world knew and had seen it. The statue, this 700-ton block of concrete and soapstone, had moved. And the world wanted to know why. Chapter 2. Joyce Greenfield felt the bracing morning air and smiled. Another beautiful day, she thought, as she skipped lightly down the steps of her brownstone apartment, holding the lead of Sebastian, her pedigree hunting dog. Sebastian was the pride of her life, at least ever since her boyfriend Adam had left her for another woman late last year. You couldn't trust men. She'd learnt that the hard way. But dogs you could trust, especially Sebastian, whom she'd had since a puppy. A wonderful little thing who had been her constant companion in both the good times and the bad. It had happened late last year, the same old cliched story heard a million times before, except this time it had happened to her. She had come home from work early one afternoon to find Adam, her beloved, the man whom she had hoped to one day marry, in bed with another woman. In their bed, an even worse betrayal. It was where they had discussed their hopes, their dreams, their ideas of what living a life together would be like. It was where Joyce had told him the little things, the secret things which made a person unique, and which she had shared with no one else. And the woman wasn't even just another woman. It was Georgina Wilcock, maybe not her best friend, but a friend nevertheless. How could a friend do that? Joyce supposed she should have known. She'd seen Georgina do the same to other women's boyfriends, even other women's husbands, but she had never suspected it would happen to her. Stupid. You couldn't trust men. Then it turned out you couldn't trust women, either. But, she repeated to herself as Sebastian trotted along obediently at her side, you could trust dogs. You could always trust dogs.
Cats were nice too, she thought, but not like dogs. She'd always agreed with the idea that there were dog people and cat people. You could like both, sure, but not equally. You had to decide one way or the other which you preferred, and she was definitely a dog person. She'd lived with dogs all her life. Her parents were dog people too, and had even found a way to smuggle Frances, her pet from the age of 6, into her college dorms for the whole 3 years she was there. She just couldn't live without dogs. She had had others over the years, often fostering dogs for animal shelters before they found permanent homes, and the stories of their lives, more often than not, reduced her to tears. How could people be so cruel? It never ceased to amaze her. Malnutrition and neglect were the least of the dog's problems. Some had been forced into fights, resulting in horrific wounds. Another had been set on fire for making too much noise during the night. One more had had all her teeth pulled out with pliers for chewing the leg of a kitchen chair. But with Sebastian, it was a clean slate. She'd always loved the breed, long and sleek but well-muscled, a ridge of hair rising along the length of its back, giving it a unique look. And some of the things it was bred to hunt. But Sebastian was a pure pet dog, bred for health and appearance, and Joyce felt herself admiring his perfect form, his long, easy gait, the way he carried his large, heavy head proudly, chest out, chin up. Being a pedigree, descended from champions, no less, he hadn't been cheap. But she had always wanted one. She earned good money, and the opportunity was there. Why not take it? And so she had paid her 500 deposit. The balance of 1,500 would be paid when a new litter was born, and she had made her selection, and put her name on the waiting list. She had never regretted the decision once, and it made her feel good to walk with him through the city streets, as she felt eyes turning towards them, admiring Sebastian. And in that admiration, she felt mutual acclaim. The fact that she was with him, making her someone to be admired. "Look at how that lady walks that beautiful dog," people would say. "She must really have something about her." And that was how she felt that morning, a deep glow of satisfaction within her, making up for all the other problems in her life. She would walk down the street, across the junction, and then into the park, where Sebastian would have a good half-hour run around, and Joyce Greenfield felt good. Sure, she worked long hours and hadn't had a proper relationship since Adam, but with the sky blue and full of promise, and Sebastian at her side, her worries faded into the background. She first felt the difference as they waited to cross the road to the park. Sebastian would normally wait patiently by her side in a perfect sit position, but this morning he seemed agitated by something. He started to fidget as they waited for the lights to change, then stood up and pulled forward, yanking her arm. Surprised, she nevertheless managed to rein him back in, and then the lights changed and they crossed for the park, although Sebastian kept on pulling her. What was wrong with him? Could he smell something, she wondered? Maybe a girl doggy over in the park. She'd been meaning to have him done for a couple of years now. After all, it was supposed to help prevent serious disease and all sort of other things. But she still thought she might breed from him one day, and so had never made the appointment. Sebastian calmed as they entered the park, and she momentarily forgot about it as they walked down the tree-lined paths towards the playing fields, where she would throw the ball for him. But then she noticed that other people walking their dogs were being jerked along by their agitated canines. As she started to pay more attention, it seemed everyone was having some problems with their dogs. And then Sebastian pulled her again, harder this time, and she fought to correct him, but he fought back and pulled her forwards, faster and faster, towards the playing fields. And now she had no control. She was just being pulled along behind him, stumbling over herself in an effort to keep up. What the hell had gotten into him? They were in the playing fields just moments later, and Sebastian paused, tense, as if sensing something beyond Joyce's comprehension. Her head snapped round at the screams that broke out seconds later, and she saw the huge dog just 200 yards away with its jaws wrapped round its owner's arm, blood gushing. Over to the other side, a pair of old ladies screamed as their little toy dogs began to snap and bite at their heels, continuing their attack as the women fell to the ground, claws and teeth going for their faces with savage ferocity. Everywhere she looked, dogs were attacking their owners, biting legs, arms, faces, necks. The green grass of the fields was stained red with fresh blood everywhere she looked. And then Sebastian turned towards her, lips pulled back in a feral snarl. No, surely not her own dog as well. Surely not Sebastian, her faithful companion. But in the blink of an eye, Sebastian launched himself at Joyce, forcing her to the ground. She cried out, as in a frenzy, his claws and teeth ripped her to pieces.
Chapter 3. Hans Glauber looked out of the little window of the huge aircraft and stifled a yawn. 4 hours already, and only halfway there. He loved his job as head of international sales for a distinguished yacht firm, but the travel could be a real killer, hopping from one continent to the next, sometimes more than 4 times in a single week. He'd grown accustomed to it now, of course, but it hardly made it any easier. He'd arrive at his hotel at about 8 in the morning, and although the temptation would be to simply crash out and get some sleep, he knew the best thing to do would be to follow his daily routine and go to bed that night at the normal time. His body would adjust to the time difference naturally this way, and he'd be absolutely fine by the following morning, which was when the big meeting was scheduled for.
"What's that?" he heard himself ask, almost without realizing.
The middle-aged lady in the seat next to him leant across to have a look.
"What's what?" she asked.
Glauber wasn't sure. He peered out of the window, looking harder.
"There!"
he exclaimed, prodding at the glass with a pudgy finger. The woman looked in the direction of Glauber's finger, towards the front of the aircraft. There was movement in the sky ahead, but she couldn't make out what it was. Glauber stared. It looked like lots and lots of tiny specks crisscrossing the sky, a long way away. Like grains of sand moving independently of one another, coming together in small groups, then separating again. How many were there? 1,000? 1,000,000?
"Are they birds?"
the lady asked him, and he realized she was right. They were birds, circling the sky maybe dozens of miles away, vast numbers of birds swarming together, separating and then swarming again. But why? In the cockpit, flight navigator Lao Che Huan turned to the pilot, Huaman.
"They're on the radar now,"
he announced, voice calm and professional.
"They must be converging."
Huan and Man had been observing the birds for some time. They were following the same course as the airplane. At first, the men had had no idea what the specks in the distance were, but after a while it became clear that they were birds. But they behaved in a way neither man had seen before, flying apart and then coming together in larger groups. And now it seemed that they had formed one enormous supergroup.
"How large?" Man asked.
"I've got no idea," Huan said,
now struggling to contain himself.
"There must be millions of them."
"But they're still some way ahead of us,"
Man said hopefully.
"Yes, sir,"
Huan answered immediately.
"They're about 12... Oh, no,"
he gasped.
"What?"
Man questioned. Huan swallowed hard.
"They're turning."
In the cabin, Glauber felt the woman beside him shudder. He'd seen it too. The birds coming together into one huge group, bigger than anything he'd thought possible. And it wasn't just Glauber and the woman. Other passengers had also noticed now. There was a collective gasp as the birds all came together, and then there were cries of alarm when the birds turned and started flying towards the aircraft. The pilot and navigator tensed as the flock swooped and turned, until it was flying directly towards them, less than 1 mile away now. Huaman tried to take evasive action, but the birds turned with him, getting closer, ever closer, until they were all he could see, all that anyone could see. The cockpit window was filled with the birds, coming relentlessly towards them, a huge black cloud of birds that seemed to fill the whole sky. Glauber watched as the birds soared towards the aircraft. The woman next to him gripped his arm reflexively, her fingers tight with anxiety. The birds swarmed from all sides, all over the aircraft, and the plane lurched up and down as if hitting turbulence. Glauber heard the woman next to him scream, heard others scream all through the cabin. And then the birds were gone, the sky outside clear once more.
"What the hell is going on?" the woman asked breathlessly. "What do they want?"
Glauber's brow furrowed as he searched the sky for the birds. What do they want? He had never considered the idea. What do animals want? Food? Shelter? To reproduce? Glauber knew that as far as an animal could want anything, it wanted to survive. But how was this behavior accomplishing anything? Flying towards the plane in a group of thousands, maybe millions, then breaking away and flying off. It seemed that the purpose was merely to frighten the people in the aircraft. But that was clearly ridiculous. Why would any animal want to do that?
"I don't know," he admitted.
There were cries from around the cabin.
"There! Over there on the right! There they are!"
And Glauber saw them again, circling in smaller groups, swarming and then breaking away as they had before. But he realized moments later that this was another group entirely. Surely it must be. The aircraft would be travelling at well over 500 miles per hour, an impossible speed for birds to keep pace with. This realization filled him with even greater horror. It was as if nature was rebelling. It seemed utterly impossible for there to be another group of these birds. But there they were, as before, coalescing into a huge, living, pulsating mass.
"They're coming again,"
Flight Navigator Juan said, his voice urgent, panic creeping in. Their flight training was rigorous. What to do in case of mechanical malfunction, terrorist attack, even how to keep control in the face of a hurricane. But nothing had prepared him for this.
"A different flock," Man said, his tone uneven, disbelieving.
Juan nodded his head. He could see the two separate groups on his radar system, the first group left far behind. Two separate groups of birds, both acting in a way which seemed to contradict the very laws of nature. What did it mean? But then this group of birds was on them also, and he heard Man grunting with the effort of keeping the plane stable as it was rocked up and down, side to side, by the army. For that was surely the word for it, of winged creatures, no longer the benign little angels that Juan had once believed them to be, but savage beasts, cruel and vindictive. The plane was rocked harder this time, for longer, but the army finally passed again, flying away to swarm and regroup. Juan breathed a sigh of relief.
"Damage report," Man
demanded, doing his best to retain his professionalism, although the sweat that dripped down his face revealed the pressure he was under. Juan's keen eyes swept the instruments, trying to identify any irregularities. Altitude, oil pressure, fuel, engine temperature, bearing, rudder adjustment. But miraculously, everything was still fine. All as it should be.
"Nothing,"
he reported, regaining some of his own composure. Glauber wasn't sure which was more frightening. The third group of birds, massing again in their millions underneath the dark, ominous clouds, creating a huge, even more menacing cloud of their own, or the scene inside the aircraft, where fear and panic were starting to take hold. Some people merely stared out of the tiny windows in open-mouthed disbelief, whilst others screamed, screams of a sort that Glauber had never heard before in his life, screams of pure terror. Children sobbed gently or cried hysterically. Actually, not just the children, Glauber realized, but men and women too. Most people who weren't screaming were crying. Others, however, were more active. Some were hammering on the cockpit door, demanding answers from the flight crew, and Glauber was disgusted as he saw a big bearded man grab a stewardess by the front of her dress and slam her into the toilet door, yelling in her face. He was tackled to the floor by other passengers. Another man had begun to talk loudly, preaching to the passengers.
"This is it. It's finally time. Better repent now. Judgment Day has come. It's the time of the apocalypse."
Further along, one family was taking down their luggage from the overhead racks, almost as if they expected to be getting off the plane at any moment, forgetting they were still 38,000 feet in the air. Shock, Glauber thought. Glauber glanced to his side, saw the woman bent with her head between her knees, muttering prayers to herself. Actually, Glauber realized it was the same prayer repeated over and over and over again. He himself wasn't in shock. He felt something different. Disbelief, perhaps? Disbelief that something like this was happening? No. As the third group of birds began to converge on the aircraft, starting their final approach in one huge amorphous mass, moving with seemingly demonic intent, Glauber realized what he felt was acceptance. He knew he was going to die. In the cockpit, Man was the first to scream, just half a second before Juan. The third attack had started the same way as the first two. Anticipating the move, Man had violently turned the aircraft, cutting across the line of attacking birds, avoiding them entirely. Man had taken a short breath, allowed himself a brief glimmer of hope. But then he saw the birds ahead had been a decoy. His evasive action had taken his airplane, his crew, and his 356 passengers directly into the path of another flock, this one even bigger, a fact neither man thought possible, but which was undeniable.
"There must be tens of millions of them,"
Man thought with a shudder, just before they reached the plane. The first line of birds hit the cockpit window, bodies breaking across the glass, bones, feathers, and blood smeared and splattered everywhere. Then the next wave hit, and the next. Wave after wave after wave of broken and smashed bodies, until the window started to break, to cave inwards. Juan, despite his fear and panic, still managed to notice the warning lights go on for the engines. First one, then two, then three, then four, until all engines were out, and his mind was still able to process the fact that the birds had flown straight into the huge, churning jet engines, sacrificing themselves to destroy the aircraft, just as the birds were doing against the windscreen in front of him. He noticed the altitude start to drop, saw how cabin pressure was being lost in the main passenger area, realized that the birds must have broken through the cabin windows. And then the reinforced glass of the cockpit finally gave way, and Juan's screams were forever silenced by a crushing mass of feathers, blood, and bone. Glauber could now hear nothing. Not the prayers of the woman next to him, nor the cries of the children, nor the screams of everyone else. Vision was his only sense, and he looked on in mute amazement as the birds flew into the jet engines mounted on the wings, hundreds upon hundreds, until the engines blew, flames and charred feathers bursting across the sky. But still the birds didn't stop, and Glauber watched with an almost fascinated terror, not even feeling the drop in altitude, the ferocious rocking of the plane's fuselage, as the broiling, seething mass succeeded in ripping the entire wing off, sending it spinning away across the sky in an almost balletic display. Glauber was still watching the wing spiraling down to earth when the first of the birds smashed through into the cabin, the pressure reducing, anything unsecured, luggage, food, drink, magazines, bodies, being sucked out by the vacuum. But then more birds entered, and nothing else could be sucked out. And Glauber felt the entire aircraft start to spin, and understood that the other engines were lost, maybe the entire wing too. His attention was now focused inside the aircraft, and he saw through the incredible shaking and spinning of the fuselage interior how the passengers were entirely covered in birds, little broken bodies smeared over people's features, and he couldn't recognize anyone anymore. There were just hundreds of people covered in bird. Terrible, bloody, greasy, broken bird. And then Glauber's window broke open, and he too was covered in bird. A terrible mass of tiny bodies breaking across his face, and he realized, too late, that more than anything else in the world, he finally wanted to scream. Chapter 4. Sirens blared in the background, almost deafening James Carter as he addressed the television camera, which picked up the scenes of chaos surrounding him. Storefronts smashed and broken, people still escaping with clothes and sneakers from the sports store behind, and with widescreen TVs and computers from the electronics store to the side. One of the buildings was on fire, along with several of the cars which lined the normally peaceful street, the flames licking perilously close to Carter as he gave his report.
"I'm here on Hudson Boulevard," he announced over the din of rioters and looters, "where chaos is running rampant. After the giant statue was seen to move last week, there have been more strange incidents all over the world. Domestic pets have attacked their owners. Birds have destroyed large passenger airplanes by flying into them in huge numbers. Zoo animals have gone on the rampage. Fish have been dying in their millions. And some people believe that these unexplained incidents are heralding the end of the world. The apocalypse."
Carter flinched instinctively as one of the cars behind him erupted in a huge fireball, then continued.
"Already, apocalyptic cults are emerging, driving people into a frenzy, claiming all sorts of things. But the bottom line is that we are all doomed."
Carter looked around to survey the carnage behind him, then turned back to the camera.
"Whether that is true or not,"
he went on, gesturing to the destruction of the neighborhood,
"it is clear that their words are having an effect. Earlier this evening, the first riot broke out here on these streets. The police managed to arrest the main offenders, and now the looters have moved in."
"It starts here, but mark my words," Carter said gravely. "It will spread. This is only the beginning." Part 2 Chapter 1
"They're behind us!"
Leanne Harness whispered urgently across the cabin of the fast-moving SUV, almost as if she expected her pursuers to be able to hear her. Carl Janklow could see the headlights in his rearview mirror, three vehicles approaching fast, gaining on them. His nerves threatened to get the better of him as he maneuvered the vehicle down the treacherous snow-covered mountain road. Huge trees veered up on either side of him, cutting out all natural light from the stars and moon and making the route seem all but impassable. And yet he knew the road was just fine. Indeed, he'd driven this way home for the past 3 years. He tried to rein in his paranoia. So there were vehicles behind them, so what? Plenty of other people lived off base, many of them in the same small town as Janklow did. But this time, Janklow had no intention of ever going back. He and Leanne had discussed the matter at length, and both had decided that they needed to go public with what was going on at the base. And now that they had made that decision and acted upon it, the fear that they had been discovered was running cold through both of them.
"If they knew," Leanne said, "why didn't they stop us at the gate?"
Janklow increased speed, the big SUV threatening to tilt over and go spinning into the trees at every turn. He shook his head.
"I don't know,"
he answered, knowing it was a lie. He knew the reason. Colonel Anderson had let them leave the base so that they could be killed out here, in the wilderness, away from prying eyes. His foot pressed the accelerator harder, and the wide tires struggled to keep a grip on the icy forest road. He saw the headlights fall away behind him and allowed himself a grin of triumph. It was short-lived. The lights were back again just moments later, closing the gap even further. Should he risk turning off into the tree line? If he could just get round the next bend fast enough, break through a gap into the trees and turn his lights off, Anderson and his men might go shooting straight past them. It was worth a try, he decided, increasing his speed even more as they shot towards another corner.
"Slow down!"
Leanne screamed at him, as she felt the tires giving way under the heavy vehicle.
"We're going to..."
The sound of automatic gunfire drowned her words. In the mirrors, Janklow saw flashes of light erupting from the vehicles behind him. He felt the impact of bullets hitting his car, heard the windows shatter. He struggled to control the car as one of the tires was blown out. He turned to Leanne to tell her to hang on, but saw only her lifeless body sagging in the seat next to him, head lolling uselessly on her chest, a round having blasted straight through the back of her seat into her body. Only then did he realize that the windscreen was covered in blood, pierced and webbed where the bullet had passed out of her body and carried on forwards. He felt instantly nauseous and vomited over the steering wheel and dashboard, even as another tire was blasted out and his car finally, spectacularly went spinning off the mountain road into the trees beyond. Colonel Easton Anderson stepped out of his jeep and smelt the air, picking up the scents of gun smoke and leaking gasoline. Good. This business would finally be put to rest. Not so very long ago, Carl Janklow had seen the computer of a technician who had been working on the base's covert sub-program. The technician had gone straight to Anderson to tell him. Anderson had chastised him for his lack of attention to security, but was happy the man had had the balls to admit he had messed up. They had put surveillance on Janklow straight away, and Anderson was perturbed, although not entirely surprised, when the computer expert had started to hack the internal system. Anderson had ordered some files to be moved, others to be changed, but there was still enough to alarm anyone looking. Anderson had allowed Janklow to probe, all the while monitoring his every step. Although it appeared that he had stumbled upon the covert project by accident, there was always the possibility that he was working for someone else. The police, the government, a foreign government. Anderson was responsible for the program's security, and he had to know if there was someone behind Janklow. It soon became apparent that there wasn't, but then the man had confided in one of his colleagues, Leanne Harness, a woman Janklow was having some sort of on-again, off-again romance with, and Anderson knew the moment was coming when he would have to act. The very next day, Janklow and Harness had announced their intention to take a weekend trip together. It was a trip Anderson could never allow to happen, and yet he didn't want to take care of the pair back at the base. There were too many people, too many questions that would be asked. And so here he was now, having followed them from the base and gunned them down. He would have liked a cleaner method, but Janklow had to be stopped in the woods, in the middle of nowhere. Things would be much easier to tidy up this way, arranged to look like some sort of unfortunate car crash. His attention was caught by one of his men, waving from the wreckage of Janklow's SUV.
"What is it?" Anderson called over.
"Janklow's not here, sir,"
came the immediate reply. Anderson sprinted towards the car until he could see the bloody remains of Leanne Harness, half thrown through the bloody windscreen.
"Check the area. Maybe he was thrown clear."
Men moved off, torches up to illuminate the snow-filled woods. If Janklow had been thrown through the windscreen, there was no way he would have survived at that speed. And yet...
"Sir!"
came another cry, over towards the other side of the road. Anderson went over, saw the tracks the soldier was pointing at with his torch. They were the tracks made by a man on skis, and led downhill, away from the mountaintop, and down to the small civilian town at the bottom.
"Damn it!"
Anderson restrained the urge to punch the trunk of the nearest tree. He called over to the crew of one of the vehicles which had come with them, a big 10-ton truck.
"Okay,"
he shouted.
"Get the snowmobiles deployed, right now."
As Janklow veered in and out of the trees, the pitch dark was almost all enveloping, causing him, on more than one occasion, to nearly ski straight into one of the huge trees that made up this sub-Arctic forest. He managed to adjust his course every time at just the right moment. The darkness wasn't quite complete. Sufficient light filtered down from the moon to aid his progress. His head throbbed from the crash, but the airbag had deployed and probably saved his life. He had known there was no point in checking, but he had felt for Leanne's pulse nevertheless, having to suppress the urge to vomit again as he held back the mop of bloody hair to feel for the carotid artery at the neck. There had been nothing. He choked back his tears, bitterly regretting that he had got her into this situation in the first place. Janklow kept skis in the back of the SUV. Shorter than conventional skis, they were designed for cross-country use, a sport he enjoyed and one of the reasons why he had chosen this remote posting. He'd made it across the road with his skis and boots just seconds before Anderson's team had arrived on the scene and was off down the mountain before Anderson reached the annihilated SUV. But now, with the cold wind whipping against his face as he shot down the mountain, weaving in and out of the trees, he heard the sound of engines behind him, high-pitched, straining. Snowmobiles. He knew they would be able to catch him, but he would not give up. The will to survive, to live, overrode his fear, adrenaline pushing him further and faster than he would have thought possible. Part of his mind wanted to give up, to just sit down in the snow and wait for the killers to finish him off. But a deeper part, one he never knew existed within him, spurred him on. And so he continued his run for freedom. Colonel Anderson piloted the lead snowmobile, leading a squad of 4 vehicles down the mountain, powerful headlights letting him see all obstacles long before he reached them. He knew Janklow had a head start, but against engine power the man had no chance, and the tracks in the snow were as clear as day. Anderson admired the man for his efforts, and the evening's action was certainly a diverting change from the normal routine. But it would soon be at an end. The sound of the snowmobiles was louder now, and the snow around Janklow was lit up by the snowmobile's headlights. And then the terrifying sound of gunfire penetrated the still air once more, and Janklow watched in terror as the soft snow was ploughed up around him, missing his skis by inches. He swerved in and out of the trees faster, cutting down at an angle across the mountain to a narrow pass that he thought the larger vehicles might not get through. He saw the lights turn to follow him, bullets ripping up more of the snow. He hit a shelf and jumped, flying through the cold air for what seemed an eternity before landing, taking the shock through his knees and hips, careening up onto a single leg before regaining his balance and carrying on down the steep slope. He heard gunfire again, felt something hit the back of his arm. Looking down, he saw a gaping wound in his coat at the bicep and realized he'd been shot, the bullet passing straight through his arm. He felt dizzy, started to lose balance, but then his peripheral vision caught movement, and he momentarily forgot about the pain and shock and turned to see what it was. His eyes went wide as he saw 2 small bear cubs. They stopped playing and watched him. Even as he carried on down the hill, his mind processed the information that the bear cubs were scared. And that would mean... The adult bear came charging towards him, snow churning up behind it, teeth bared and reflecting dimly in the faint moonlight. Janklow's heart almost stopped, but he aimed himself towards a log with a drift of snow lying up its side. He sailed up it just as the huge animal reached out for him. He flew off the other side in a high arc, hit the ground and stumbled, blood loss from his arm making his coordination suffer. And then... He was rolling, the skis striking the ground and flying off into the trees beyond, his body curling into a pain-filled ball as it shot down the mountainside. Anderson recognized the sound and knew he should avoid the area, but he simply didn't have the time, and before he knew it, his headlights picked up the ferocious image of a bear charging through the snow towards him. He pulled off left at the last minute, and his snowmobile slammed straight into a tree and sent him sailing through the air. The bear brought its great paws crashing down onto the front of the second snowmobile, crushing it instantly and sending the pilot tumbling across the snow. The huge beast ignored the man, now curled into a ball on the ground in a last-ditch effort to protect himself, and launched herself at the last 2 snowmobiles, which were trying to take evasive action. One swipe of the bear's huge paw sent one driver flying into the trunk of a nearby tree. Directly behind, the driver of the 4th snowmobile piloted the craft straight into the animal. The driver was thrown from the snowmobile, but the bear was propelled backwards, letting out a roar of pain and anger as she came down onto all 4s. Anderson, covered in snow, used the momentary distraction to get to his knees. Using the broken snowmobile as a rest, he laid his rifle on the top and aimed at the bear through the weapon's night sight. The bear, recovering and still protecting her cubs from the perceived threat, reared back once more onto her hind legs, raising her arms above her head, ready to smash them down into the body of the driver which had hit her. And then her chest erupted in a spray of blood as Anderson opened fire, peppering the 1,000-pound mammal with an entire magazine of high-velocity ammunition. Anderson watched in wonder, as the bear stood still for several moments, as if contemplating her injuries. Anderson was halfway through reloading his rifle, when finally, with a deep, rumbling groan, the huge animal fell to the ground, dead. Moments later, ignorant of the danger, the 2 cubs came bounding over, nuzzling the dead bear and emitting wailing cries. Anderson ignored them, anger taking over. The snowmobiles were out of action, and who knew what state his men were in? With a sigh of resignation, he accepted that Carl Janklow had escaped. Janklow finally came to rest at the bottom of the mountain. Even though the snow was thick and deep, he had still smashed into fallen branches, rocks, and stones on his way down. He was badly battered and barely conscious. He staggered to his feet, half falling through the last of the trees, and stumbled out of the forest onto the dark grey asphalt of a road. He turned one way, then the other, and saw lights heading towards him. He held back, worried it might be more soldiers from the base. But then he saw the multi-leveled lights and realized it was a commercial truck. Almost delirious with the joy of a survivor, he stepped out into the road, waving his good arm frantically. The truck sounded its horn, and Janklow wondered if it was going to hit him and end everything right there and then. But then the brakes were applied, and the huge truck started to slow down. By the time the truck driver got out of the cab to help him, Janklow had passed out and lay unconscious on the icy road, his head filled with a single thought before oblivion.
I've made it.
Chapter 2. Alyssa Durham's fingers pinched the tiny outcrop of rock with a vice-like grip. The sides of her painfully tight climbing shoes pressed against the almost sheer surface for added traction. She was free climbing a 100-foot granite cliff face, a short climb for her, but made difficult due to the low temperature, which ensured the wall was covered in a thin layer of ice. In earlier years, she would have done the climb as a free solo, without ropes for protection. But now, as the lone parent of a beautiful 8-year-old daughter, she was not willing to risk making that child an orphan. And so she used ropes, but only to save her if she fell. She wouldn't use them as an aid in her climbing. Her daughter, Anna, was higher up the mountain skiing. Alyssa was a good skier herself, but Anna was something else. She'd started at the age of 5 and shown a natural aptitude for it. They went to the mountains every opportunity they got, which wasn't as much as Alyssa would have liked. Her job was demanding, and there was only one of her, after all. But it was enough for Anna to have become pretty incredible for an 8-year-old. The trips had started after the death of her husband, Patrick. He had contracted a rare form of degenerative disease at a shockingly young age, and Alyssa had nursed him for 12 painful months before, mercifully for him, agonizingly for her and Anna, he had quietly passed away one night. She had cried for hours, helpless tears, hopeless tears, but had gathered herself before Anna woke. She needed to be strong for her, and although both Alyssa's parents and Patrick's parents were a huge help, the fact of the matter, at least as Alyssa saw it, was that Anna was her responsibility and nobody else's, and she was now all that remained of Patrick. Anna herself had found it hard to deal with her father's death. He had been ill for some time and had not been involved in her upbringing during that final painful year, but the gap that he left was difficult for a young girl to deal with.
"Where's Daddy?"
she would ask incessantly, especially before bedtime, when he used to read stories to her before kissing her goodnight.
"When's Daddy coming home?"
It was hard for Alyssa to explain, and Anna had cried for days, for weeks, and Alyssa had cried along with her. It wasn't until their first trip into the mountains a few months after Patrick's death that Anna had started to come round. The magical quality of the snow, the serene peace of the valleys, the majesty of the mountains themselves had shown Anna another view of the world, perhaps of something beyond it, and given her hope. And Alyssa had felt it too, the pull of something beyond, the first faint rays of a life beyond the one that had been wrenched so terribly from them. Alyssa and Patrick had been winter sports addicts, skiing, snowboarding, ice climbing. Anything that could be done, they would do it. They had even met on a mountain, thousands of miles from home, and when holiday romance had bloomed, they were delighted to find they lived only 100 miles from one another back home. Alyssa's first love was climbing, and had been since she was a little girl, but Patrick's was snowboarding, and he had shown her everything he knew. They were wonderful years, those early years, getting away whenever work let them. She was an up-and-coming journalist, cutting her teeth on the local papers, but determined to break into the nationals. He was an up-and-coming public prosecutor, destined for the DA's office. But then Anna had come along, and it wasn't so easy to get away anymore. They hadn't regretted it, not for a second. On the contrary, their years of adventure were simply put aside as other priorities took hold. But when Patrick died, the first place Alyssa had thought to take Anna, after the worst of the grieving was over and behind them, was the mountains. If Patrick had loved them, she thought, maybe Anna would too. And she had, with a wild abandon. And for the first time in as long as she could remember, Alyssa had felt free, the strains of her life miraculously lifted. Anna had wanted to ski. She was adamant about that, having watched as people shot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.